All right, here we go.
So for me, the shock of this movie when I saw it was that Pixar, or anybody other than Joe's House of Movies, had made a an animated short about religion.
Right.
It was a shocker. And I don't know that anybody else was quite as shocked as I was in the room. I couldn't tell. But it seemed like a remarkably brave choice on the part of Pixar. Did it seem that way to you guys?
Well, I mean, we've always felt that this was a story about Sanjay and his dad. And yes, religion is at the core of it, but the emphasis is on your relationship with your dad as an immigrant.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, when we pitched, you know, I think the initial concept was, I wasn't shying away from mythology, religion, spirituality, because that's, you know, the original inspiration came from my father and the rituals and the practice that he had every morning. I then showed a drawing to John, which virtually illustrated the, you know, the sort of kind of standard setup with the boy and the father on opposite sides of the rooms. And I explained to him quite simply that my dad worshipped in his shrine every morning, which was to the Hindu gods, and I worship my gods. They happened to be the superheroes on the TV, and that was my shrine. But, you know, it wasn't something that, you know, I'd fabricated or sort of invented. That was absolutely the reality of how I grew up here in LA. And so at once, it was very much an American story. It was a personal story. And yeah, there's, you know, a huge aspect that's also, you know, inclined towards spirituality and religion. But at bottom, I think John recognized that this is a true story and this is a very personal story. And so I think he really encouraged me to pursue that. And he, you know, in many ways, he really gave me the confidence to just tell my own story. You know, so often people are like, well, I have a story. And, you know, and of course they don't. And, you know, for me, that experience was something that I just wouldn't tell anybody, just because it just felt so, you know, growing up, it just felt kind of embarrassing because it felt very different. And so,
as it does for Sanjay in the movie.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Right. But you want to finish your thought, but just in terms of the religious thing, I just wanted to say, it's not that we were unaware of the religious part of it. And we took a lot of care to consult with people who are from, you know, who are experts at Hinduism. Obviously, Sanjay has done his homework. He's super knowledgeable and reverent. But it's not like we were unaware that that was also an issue we needed to be sensitive about. And we got some really good input from people about things that we should steer away from or be sensitive about. Little tiny things, just to make sure that those who are more sensitive practitioners of the religion wouldn't be offended.
It's interesting. No, it's just, I think the movie is universal. That's one of the great things about it. But I also think it's, you know, movie people have avoided, you know, Christianity and Judaism and
sure,
you know, everything else for so many years. That
right.
To see it come to, certainly in animation, it's kind of a non-issue. I guess that we have the Prophet this year, which is a little
right.
Taste of it. Though
right.
Even that is kind of irreligious in some ways.
Sure.
But the embrace of what is a very much a part of probably the majority of people in the planet's daily lives.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
It's also kind of a very gutsy choice.
Yeah.
Oh, it's super gutsy. I just love that, you know, again, I came in really confident and proud, having spent, you know, most of my life being ashamed and embarrassed of, I don't know, my parents, their identity, their culture, let alone my own skin. And so it just felt like I'd done so much, I'd spent so much time being so afraid and embarrassed of not fitting in and not being like everybody else, that finally when I sort of turned the corner and I discovered the mythology and I did all this reading, I just felt so inspired and proud that I was like, this matters. This isn't bogus, man. This isn't hot air. This matters. And I think there's a way to talk about it with people that, you know, you don't sound like a zealot. And there's a way to talk about it. You know, I guess I just, whenever I sort of talked about it and I showed my books to my friends at Pixar, everybody there was so inspired and fired up about it. And I think, you know, I had been to a couple of different art schools here in the States, and I just was never exposed to South Asian art. And I think it was probably the same for many of my colleagues in terms of the animators at Pixar. They had no clue about the Mahabharata, the Ramayana. And you know what? Those are pretty cool stories. And then on top of that, there's an amazing amount of philosophy. And underneath that, there's all this wisdom, timeless wisdom. And it's just this endless sort of well. And I don't know, as I just got older and I got more and more fascinated about stories that had timeless sort of resonance, it just seemed to show up in these myths from my parents' culture, these myths that I just had ignored.
I have to say that because of working with you on this film, I've come to appreciate Asian art more because of these stories. It's easy to go to the museum and you see this Asian art and it all kind of looks like something foreign and different, and you don't really know who all these deities are. But once you understand the mythology behind it, suddenly all of that art comes to life, which is kind of the theme of this movie, right? Yeah. That you first go into this temple and it's gray and kind of dead, and it comes to life when he lights that candle, which, you know, for us is that candle of knowledge and understanding and appreciation. So I've had that experience personally. I've gone to the museum with this guy, you know, and he's running from sculpture to sculpture and explaining who these deities are, and it's really exciting.
Well, it's funny because like somebody like Jim Henson, you know, everybody is used to the Muppets, but he was very much into exploring all this kind of stuff, and cultural stuff, and was very deep into it. And people rarely saw it. There'd be an occasional exhibition in New York or something, but it was so much at the core of everything he did, even though it wasn't expressed so clearly. It was kind of fascinating how artists, you acquiring all this information leads to everything else, I guess.
Right.
For sure.
That well of inspiration.
Yeah. So where did this start in terms of actually getting started?
Oh, gosh. You know, I'll say that I'd been, Nicole's been at Pixar for 20 years. It's going to be 20 years for me next year. And I'd spent, most of that time, at least 15 years of it or 10 years of it, just being a great, good student of animation and Pixar sort of storytelling. And then at a certain point, I just felt like I'd kind of burnt out on, European art, Western art, American animation. You know, I was kind of obsessed with it all throughout my childhood. Mm-hmm. And I was looking for new inspiration, and that's when I had come across, it's kind of embarrassing, but rave music was incredibly popular during the mid-90s. And there was this kind of strain of rave music called Goa Trance, which was being, it has this kind of psychedelic roots that was kind of ubiquitous in San Francisco. And a lot of the album art had kind of, had a lot of the South Asian imagery, spiritual imagery from my parents' shrine. I was like, what in the heck? I was obsessed with the music, and they were sampling, different mantras that my parents made me say growing up. And suddenly I was like, this was cool. Everybody around me was like really into it. And I suddenly felt safer to explore it. And it kind of gave me a chance to take a second look. And that's, again, when I finally discovered, through the vehicle of art, the stories. I had seen the images in my parents' shrine, but I never understood the stories. And that's when finally these statues suddenly sprang to life. So then I'd spent, the following, almost 10 years at home working diligently, night and day, reading and then doing my own book reports, which turned into books that got published. Because, again, I never got that knowledge. And so I was so hungry for it. And then I just felt like I was at this crossroads, coming upon 20 years, that I just felt like, there was just this avalanche of, students coming out of art school that were just killed to sit in my chair and animate on a Pixar movie. And more I just felt like there wasn't this avalanche of students dying to reillustrate these myths and tell them to, this culture here in the West. And I just felt like, oh gosh, somebody's got to do that. And I just felt like, I want to do it. And and so I just felt like, it felt like a big calling to me to to recontextualize these stories, to be able to share them with my friends. And so.
You just go to Lasseter's office and kick down the doors at the end.
Quite the opposite.
I mean, maybe you want to jump in here.
Well, I wasn't working with Sanjay at the time. I had actually seen his books in the studio and was a fan from a distance. We hadn't worked together. But I know that after writing the books, he was invited to do these shows at the Asian Art Museum, and folks from Pixar saw them and said, oh, you should do a show at Pixar. We have a gallery there to show employee artwork. And when that show was up, John walked past it. It's right near his office. And was blown away and said, Sanjay, you need to make a film. And that's not what Sanjay had signed up for. So it kind of, I think, threw you off a little bit. That's not what you were planning to do. You didn't feel like that was your thing. So you kind of ignored the call a few times before they finally dragged you in, as I've heard.
Yeah, I mean, it was Jim Morris, the president of Pixar, finally, you know, he asked me what was going on, why hadn't I responded. And, you know, and I just felt, you know, convinced that there was just no room for the stories that I wanted to tell, the place that I wanted to explore. You know, I was really interested in my parents' culture. I was really interested in these mythological sort of tales. It just didn't seem appropriate for Pixar. And, you know, he begged to differ. And he's like, we're always interested in different stories. And so finally had a conversation with my father. And, you know, and he really pointed out that the studio had sort of had stood by my side for the better part of 20 years. They had invested in me. And he just thought, like, for me to walk away from what they were asking would create bad karma. Mm-hmm. And karma is a big deal for him. And he thought it was my duty to at least try. And I took that very seriously.
So you were just really, like, just didn't think it would happen. You thought you were going to get you're going to start down a road and just be disappointed by it mm-hmm. never coming together or something?
I just, you know, I'm a shy introvert. I'm like, I'm a worker bee at Pixar. You know, there was nothing in me that I went to art school because I like drawing the thing. I don't like telling other people to draw the thing. I'm just really satisfied, you know. When I was like a little boy, I liked just being in a room with a piece of paper and drawing. It hasn't changed till this day. The idea of being in a room with a lot of people with no drawing implements, telling people what to do using my words, is horrifying. That's not pleasure.
And it was a subject matter, too. I mean, that was the thing. You really didn't believe that you could tell the kinds of stories that you wanted to tell through Pixar. And
totally.
So that was a huge thing to overcome. But then you went in development. People in development helped pull this out of you. And then it was John who really saw that core story about a father and son. Because that's not where you went originally.
Totally. I mean, most of the credit really does go to John. I mean, he gambled. Like I said, I would not have believed this would have ever happened. I'm still shocked. You said you were stunned. So am I. John wasn't. You know, John said, nobody has ever pitched me something like this. I love it. He really found resonance in it. And he really believed in exactly how I grew up with my father. And mm-hmm. he just really fought. You know, he kept reminding me. He's like, just tell that truth. Mm-hmm. He never said, make it funnier, make it, you know, more dramatic, change mm-hmm. this, change that. He always just said, you know, just be true to you and your father's experience. You know, like, when do you hear that?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So what was the first day of telling people what to do with your voice like for you?
Well, you kind of creeped out onto that stage a little bit. We brought in a production designer who really partnered well with Sanjay. And so it was just him and this production designer. You know, it was a slow kind of, you know, tiptoeing onto stage. And all of a sudden, you know, you were in front of like 30 people and we just kind of, We snuck that in gradually. But I mean, Sanjay learned how to partner with other people. We have a lot of really talented people. And as you gained their trust and you began to believe in them, mm-hmm. things seemed to get easier for you.
Until it completely like shattered at the very end, I think. Yes, I was
warming
up.
As they always do.
I was warming up until I think we hit lighting. Lighting's a part of our production where, you know, everything's animated, everything's built, and we are now essentially adding, you know, the colors and the shadows. Mm-hmm. And that's really where language sort of broke down for me. You know, it's such a visual medium, and I just didn't have the faculty to be able to communicate what I wanted to see just because I couldn't even mm-hmm. articulate it until I, you know, sort of painted it. And so it was really hard to use words to express, I don't know, the subtlety of an image. And so mm-hmm. that became really hard. You mm-hmm. know, I was suddenly in a room with like 30 people, as Nicole was saying, the pressure was on. This was virtually at the end of the project. Mm-hmm. There was no time, and our project was going to live or die by the lighting. That was very stressful.
Right. But then the breakthrough was realizing you could draw it, you could paint it, and Chris Sasaki, our production designer, could paint it, and you could go, that's what I want. And then the lighting team knew which direction to go in.
Yeah, suddenly, like, we didn't have to rely on words. We found this other tool, which was right. painting, to yeah. sort of clear that final hurdle.
Ironic for an animator. Painting was the tool you had to seek. Totally. It was hard to find.
Totally. You know, I guess you just don't know. You know, you're in these rooms, and you're like, okay, you know, there isn't a paintbrush and a canvas sitting around, nor is there the time to sit there and paint and, you know, right. illustrate what the concept that you're trying to express, let alone explore it.
Right.
And so you're essentially using words to help, I don't know, ignite somebody else's mind to explore it. And that's,
right.
I found incredibly hard.
Right, because you don't know exactly what it is you want. You know kind of what you want, but you need to iterate on that. And I think that was a difficult time. And I think it's a challenge for all directors, frankly, that lighting is really difficult for that reason. You need a really good lighting DP is the role at Pixar, someone who can either paint it or can iterate on the computer and show you a lot of different things for you to pick from.
I mean, the subject matter alone, I mean, we're in this moment where, you know, we're in the cosmic realm of the deities. Mm-hmm. You know, I was just so adamant that, you know, I really wanted this very different look than we are, you know, that we have then in the apartment. And, you know, we just couldn't rely on the sort of the physics of what light and shadow operates like in the real world. I just felt like we're free of that. Let's be more abstract. Let's really, you know, get into this cosmic sort of realm. And I could say that, but what does that look like?
Right. Yeah, I mean, to have characters who were themselves light sources, you know, that was something that we had to discover.
We didn't have a ground plane. We didn't have shadows. I mean,
right.
That was a very big hurdle
and,
for all
of us. And a color language. I mean, it was a breakthrough for us to realize that we needed to simplify and just have the colors of those three deities on screen. I remember that because we had a lot of different color. You didn't even know where to look for a while. And then when we figured out we had, if you look at it, you know, the blue, the red, the green of those deities, it simplified the screen and it made it clear where you needed to look. But that was a breakthrough. I mean, it wasn't obvious.
No kidding.
In retrospect, you think,
Sanjay's
well.
Still suffering.
I am, man. It's like, I mean, we all were. It was such a painful moment. We're like, nah, duh, of course we should have done that.
But I think it was John, actually, who helped us guide us back there.
It really was. You know, again, we just had like rainbow of deities and we had rainbow of the environment. And it was yeah, it was a bit much. It was way too much.
Well, it's funny because of color scheme wise and all of that, it kind of seems like it would have been a more of a fit with Inside Out than it is with the dinosaur in the way.
It's true. Maybe. It's good to have contrast.
And also theoretical, you know, the concept is somewhat similar.
Right.
For sure,
deities doing different things and all that. But I guess contrast is...
We were definitely inspired by things that they had done in Inside Out, for sure. That was very helpful. We learned from it. But, you know, yeah, contrast is a good thing. We always like that our short films are really different from the features because it just shows the spectrum of our ability, right?
Yes. Well, it was fascinating, actually, and I had this conversation with Brad, but that people were actually... there was, like, this kind of weird backlash against Lava that I still don't quite understand.
Yeah, well, a lot of people loved it.
Yeah.
But yes, there were others who didn't. The old cynical people.
Old cynical people, and then somehow there was a sexist thing that people kind of brought to it. Like somehow it was a male mountain and a young, pretty, you know, an old male mountain and a young, pretty other mountain. It's like, what?
Yeah,
I know.
People like read into things, and but I guess it hasn't happened on Sanjay on this Sanjay Super Team.
Gosh, so far, no.
It does all the reading for you. It does. You're just trying to get it all in your head while you're watching it. So did you, once you got past that, did you feel like, I got through it, I made it, we're done? Or was that still feeling like an unfinished bed for you?
No, I think once the story started to coalesce and then once the lighting really sort of, you know, locked in, I was so relieved, beyond relieved. And then after that, you know, I feel like, I remember going through this with all my other books too, like my fiance points this out. I kind of go through this mourning process where I'm like, I don't even want to look at that thing. I don't even want to talk about it. I'm like, I'm leaving, you know? I really need to get I need to get some distance from it.
Right.
But it was such a relief to finally have the lighting, you know, land. You know, and one of the last things that finally came together was the music.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're a pantomime short, there's no dialogue, and, we have some heady things that we're going for, you know, and music could really make or break this. It could really turn it into something stereotypical or something that's, you know, maybe sublime and help you sort of have this transcendent experience, which is very much what I wanted, you know, as well as a fun experience too. And we had this talented sound designer, Justin Pearson, who temped some beautiful stuff for us. And then, you know, we got this amazing opportunity to collaborate with Michael Dana. And man, we just had such good karma with this guy. He was being courted at the studio to work on The Good Dinosaur, and we had been told that, hey, we might, you know, work with him, and you know, potentially sort of to talk to him, I think, or we're going to sort of meet him in the sort of the lobby.
Yeah, it was a very casual in passing, you know, no pressure. Oh, he's going to be walking down here. Could you come downstairs? Exactly.
Literally, we were having lunch. He was having lunch, and you know,
like, yeah, waved him over just for a minute.
No, it genuinely did happen that way. Mm-hmm.
Casual matchmaking.
Yeah, and it's like, you know, Tom McDougall, you know, the music supervisor at Disney, he helped us introduce us. And, you know, we were talking with Michael, and, you know, I was a new dad, and I was like, I mentioned my son. I was like, his name is Arjun. And Michael did a double take. He's like, my son is named Arjun. I'm like, what? You know, he's a, you know, Caucasian guy from Canada. I'm like, what? And it turns out his wife's Bengali. And, I'm like, dude, how brown are you? He's like, trust me, I'm pretty brown. We high-fived, of course. And, you know, he really has a huge sensitivity to the community and the culture. And that was huge. You know, I think on the second time we saw him, we ran into him at lunch. And then he's like, hey. You know, he's like, I know your stuff. He's like, actually, I have one of your books. He's like, you did the Rom Iron. This is my second book that I'd illustrated. And he's like, hang on. And he ran off, got his book bag. And there in his book bag is, like, his copy of, you know, from the 70s of Rom Iron that William Buck had written. And he was like saying that it's a dog-eared book. And it's a book that he had been reading to his kids, you know, at night. And he really, really just had a deep appreciation for the myths, the stories, and he got it. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a moment toward the end of the short where Vishnu anoints the boy on his forehead. And, you know, we had explored that idea with Justin, but Michael introduced the Bansuri flute in that moment. And it was such a sensitive choice that, you know, that flute is a very spiritual instrument in India. It's very much linked to one of the avatars of Vishnu. And again, most people never know that, but for my father and his community, they would totally get it. It was such a sensitive choice that I think Michael appreciated because he had that wealth of knowledge.
Michael's a sensitive guy.
Yeah. He is a sensitive guy.
He's great. He was great.
So how sensitive are you as a producer? I mean, you usually say producer and you go, you know, the whip is cracking and all that stuff. But is it different in a situation like this? It sounds like there was a lot of emotional management as much as anything else.
Well, and I do think that's a big part of the producer role. Yes, I think producers get a bad rap for being, you know, cracking the whip, being really focused on money and that kind of thing. And I think it's a creative partnership. I think it's important for a producer to be sensitive to what the director's trying to achieve. And I saw myself as making it happen. I was enabling a lot of what his vision was. I had to be aggressive perhaps with other people or with the studio and other resources to get what he needed, to get him the time, to get access to certain artists. Sometimes other people wanted to say no, and I had to make it happen. But I only did that, obviously, when I really believed in what it was you were trying to do. And I believed in the film. It was a beautiful film, and it was worth kind of going to the mat to make it happen. So, yeah, sensitive with Sanjay, maybe not with other people.
Actually, I got to jump in here. She's a really good soul. I definitely came into this this experience with like a lot of sort of like arms up around producers, like, oh, that's the other side, man. That's production. I think it's really awful to say, but you know, I think somebody from, as an artist, you're just like, that's management. Like, we don't want to let them in the clubhouse. And I really had a very arms up like attitude. I was very distrustful. But Nicole she's a wonderfully sensitive human being, and she really helped me sort of open my eyes. You know, I'll just say this about Nicole. Nicole's great. I don't want to, I can't speak to a larger pool of producers, but she kicks butt because, you know, I think she's great. She was in this perfect storm of the good dino needed every resource on the planet. And it was really just, she just didn't have any resources, and she really had all the favors, and she really cashed them all in to sort of help us get this thing made, because it was a huge ask. There was so many different assets. There were so many unknowns that we had to tackle. And for the most part, she really kept saying yes. And that was huge. She didn't have to, and She never got mad. That was the nice thing. I feel like I would definitely retreat if I got the disapproving look. Maybe once she took off her glasses.
about that moment for months.
As an animator, I'm really sensitive to like physical score and choreography. I was like, oh my God, shit, she's never taken off her glasses that way. It was like, this, she's serious now. But she's, I think she's a really good coach and a really good partner for sure. And she has a huge sensitivity to what we were trying to do with a short. I really felt that. So I think it was up. Really fantastic partnership.
As a complete outsider to this whole thing, really, I mean, when you say, like, I'm going to get that artist, I need that artist.
Mm-hmm, right.
Well, is that just, is there, because there's a sequence that you think that artist can turn the corner on in a different way, or is there?
Yeah, I would say, yeah, sometimes there are specific artists who are particularly suited to accomplishing something in animation, in lighting, in simulation. And sometimes it wasn't a particular person, but I knew I need someone for 3 weeks. There's nobody available. I have to go and talk to someone else in the studio, another producer or another resource manager, and say, look, I need this person for 3 weeks. Come on. How can we make this happen? You know, and you have to negotiate. I mean, that's where when the elbows come out and you're just being aggressive about getting that to happen. And I knew also the artists really wanted to work on this. That's always the ace in the hole for me. Because I know if the artist really wants to do it, you know, we are a great studio in that regard, in that we want our artists to be happy and satisfied artists. It might mean that sometimes they have to work extra hours in order to complete the work that they're doing on the short or on the feature, but if they're engaged and happy, they'll do that. And so we'll do what we can to make it possible to get them to do that work on the short and still also get over to that feature and get that work done.
So when you're in a place like Pixar as a producer, is knowing that landscape and, you know, the bodies that are on board and who does what and all of that, it's your biggest job? Is that the most challenging part of?
It's vital. I mean, it's not all on the producer. Obviously, there are a bunch of other people in that hierarchy who are doing that work. But yes, the production management hierarchy and the producer are managing those resources to get that beautiful film done. And those resources are people and time. Mm.
Is it ever easier? I mean, obviously, Pixar has this incredible track record and all these great people and a lot of experience and all of that. Does it ever, are any of these films easy?
No. We keep improving the technology and then we raise the bar for what we want to do visually and creatively. And I think that's why people love working there. It's always a challenge, but that's what we live for, right? We want to raise the bar. We want it to be interesting and beautiful. We're not just going to like pump out the same thing over and over again. Who wants to do that, right? Yeah. So no, it doesn't get easier.
I mean, honestly, I think Nicole is in such an impossible, like, you know, sort of situation. Here we are, like, I'm coming in with, like, you know, I don't know, the most sort of sacred sort of matter possible, right? This is not only sort of, you know, majorly significant to, like, my parents, but to, like, you know, the other side of the world, let's say. And so I'm in there, you know, as, like, the, you know, I don't know, pesky artist being like, the deities have to have jewelry. What are you talking about? We cannot have jewelry. I'm like, this is the deities. Have you not, you know, I'm barking because I'm like, the deities are resplendent with deities, have flowing robes, and like they're covered in jewels. Meanwhile, Nicole is trying to balance the cost of that. You know, I mean, again, most people might not pick up on these details, but to ornament the deities and to have these flowing sort of robes was, there was a lot of blood that was spilt over that.
Yeah.
And she was right in the middle of that.
That is technically extremely challenging.
And so are animated jewels more expensive than real jewels? Or?
Yeah, it depends. Depends on what you want them to do.
Well, she's in this position where the technical folks are saying, hey, it's all possible. It's just given the short's timeline and budget. This is huge. This is an impossible ask.
Right.
Given what we were, a short film. And then I'm on the other side saying, but they're deities. We cannot let out, you know, we have to do right by the deities and this community and this culture. Do not make me blah-de-dee-blah. And so then there's poor Nicole, like, having to, like, figure out how to honor both.
Well, we have wonderful technical people. We had a great supervising technical director, Darwin Peachy. We had a great simulation specialist, Jacob Brooks. I mean, it's the Pixar thing. We have people who are brilliant at this. And they're also brilliant at figuring out how to thread that needle to get what he wants in the amount of time that we have. And so, yes, some blood was spilled, but, you know, it's all about compromise, negotiation, and we got to a place where I think they're beautiful and they're not all simulated. and they're resplendent, and yet they didn't break the bank.
And in fact, if I actually got what I was sort of barking for, it would have been actually too much and too distracting.
That's right.
So it was a good example where limitations actually really helped me.
Yeah.
So when did you get happy about the movie? Were you are you at peace now, or were you, have you been at peace?
Post-press, for sure. You know, seeing actually, you know, how just how much kind of positivity people have been expressing out in the media and the press. That's great, you know. I mean, people genuinely seem like they're surprised, number one, and then touched by the film. That's great. I mean, what more could we ask for?
Mm-hmm. Have you shown it to your dad?
Yes.
So, yeah, we brought him up to the studio once, and we showed it to him once. I'm actually driving out to pick him up today, and I'm going to go with my brother and my mom, and we're all going to try to sit down and see it in the movie theater with an actual public.
I thought you were going to bring your iPhone and just... So what was his reaction?
Oh, man, he was so emotional about it. You know, I was really impressed. I mean, the short... So my dad hasn't seen a movie in like 35, 40 years. The last movie he saw was The Sound of Music, you know, it was when we left the UK. So he has never seen an animated film. He's never seen a Pixar film. He's never seen any of the films that I've worked on. And so then I'm asking him to like watch this like super concentrated 6-minute film that just has this like, I don't know, avalanche of like stimulation in this booming sort of theater. And I'm like, I don't know how this is going to go down.
Well, let me just point out, with video cameras pointed at him. Because we asked if we could videotape him having this experience, you know. And he was so gracious about it. Came in, sat down, he put a microphone on. And then he sat and watched this, you know, piece about him.
Yeah, it was, I can't imagine what that experience was like for him. But yeah, and he watched it. I was so impressed, you know, straight away he like, you know, reflected back to me what he thought the short was about. He's like the father and son, they look into each other's eyes and they figure out a way to compromise. And I just thought that was beautiful. He got really emotional. Nicole was asking him some questions, and it seemed like, you know, I think my dad's always been very proud of me, but I think he was really proud to see how far I've come, and I think he was really proud as a parent to see all of the hard work he's done. I mean, the guy's an immigrant. He came here with very little, and he's just never stopped working. And to see that all that hard work has paid off in my efforts, and
I have to say, too, to see that his son saw what he had done, to appreciate him, and had really understood the religion that had sustained him, and to respect it. I mean, that is an amazing gift to a parent, I think. So, you know, I get emotional talking about it because, you know, as a parent, as a child and as a parent myself, I have come to really appreciate that bond and how different it is depending on what side of it you're on. And Sanjay finally kind of looked back and understood what his father had done.
And have you had other cultural landmarks in terms of showing the film where you kind of get a sense of how people feel about it?
Well, I mean, I've been getting a few photos here and there from different friends on social media with, I don't know, like their nieces and nephews holding up a little plush doll of little Sanjay. the Disney stores have commissioned a little plush doll of our character.
And how weird is that, right?
I felt it was super surreal at the moment, you know, when they were sort of, you know, creating it. I was like, oh my God, this is very weird. But now seeing this little character out there, you know, for, you know, kids to sort of latch onto, I was like, that's really cool, actually. It's really, really, really cool.
And you ready for a feature?
No.
Do you have any urge? I mean, do you have any natural instinct to want to do more?
You know, I was really happy having had 10 years to sort of play by myself and to explore it. You know, that felt really great. I'm in no rush to take any next steps. I'm enjoying my son right now. He's taking up all the sort of the oxygen and the air right now. And in the meantime, I've been reading, and those are my happy spots, you know?
So there's no, are you at Pixar still? Or are you?
Yeah.
So you're back to your table and just doing the work you were doing before?
Yeah, that's right.
And enjoying it?
Yeah, I'm grateful, you know, to be honest. It's, you know, there's so many people that came in and helped us on our short and worked so hard. It feels really nice to, you know, turn back, right back around and get back into production and help another director execute his vision, you know? Mm. Feels great.
So you're not anxious to do Cars 4? Dory 3 or whatever.
I'm excited on the project that we're working on right now. It feels like such a privilege, actually.
We'll keep working on him. Maybe he'll direct a feature sometime.
Will you have to drag him to it again?
Is that most your... likely.
Do you feel like you have the language? I mean, if you were forced to do it at, I don't know what kind of point, to do another short or do another a feature, do you feel like you have the tools now to get through it happily?
I think there's something in, like, I don't know what it is about the culture, but it's like we're all just in this rush. And it's like, I mean, I don't think it's a bad thing to let some of the fruit ripen a little bit, you know? I don't know. So hence, I'm really grateful that I have a job still, that I could help out on somebody else's project. And I don't know, process all that's happened, you know?
Which would be so much more complicated if you had an Oscar to go with it.
Don't jinx it, man. Don't jinx it.
Thank you guys for your time. I appreciate it.
Hey, man. It was great talking to you, David.
Great conversation, David. Thank you.